Good morning, everybody. It's good to be with you here this morning and just together to seek the Lord and to be with Him this morning. And so let's enter into a time of worship.
Who you are,
This next song is called Closer, and it just expresses a desire to do just that. As we sing this song, there just might be things in our lives and our hearts that are keeping us from drawing closer to Him, that are keeping us from walking more intimately with Him. So as we sing, just have the freedom to just surrender those things to Him, that we might walk closer with Him.
Your heart.
closer than my Everest step, closer than the song I sing, closer than anything, closer than my every breath, closer than my Everest step, closer than the song I sing, closer than anything, closer than my to wait above them all. His faith, alas, the earth he formed. His praise resounds beyond the stars and echoes in our hearts. The greatest one of all. His face shines brighter than the sun. His grace as boundless as his love. He reigns with healing in his wings, the King above all kings, the greatest one of all. Lift up our eyes, see the King has come. Light of the world reaching out for us. There is no other name, there is no other name. Jesus Christ our God. When all the world seems lost. I'll stand. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Sing to Jesus, Lord of our shame, Lord of our sinful hearts. He is our great Redeemer. Sing to Jesus, honor his name. Sing to Jesus, his is the throne. Let's continue to worship our Savior this morning. The ushers are going to come forward to receive this morning's offerings. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the price you paid. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for unending grace. And thank you for your hope. Thank you for this life you give. There is no one like you. There is no one like you, God. And all my hope is in you. Jesus.
Pray. Lord, we've been looking up. We've been opening our hearts, been worshiping you. We continue to do so as we pray. We unite our faith right now. And Lord, many of us are coming from a world, a neighborhood, a home, a workplace where it's chaotic, and might even be ungodly, but we've walked into this room on this day, and we desire to encounter God, the one true living God, Jesus, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God that has always been and forever will be, the God that saves, the God that heals, our Lord, our Savior, our soon-coming King. We come here to worship you. And we've carried Bibles in, your love letter. We've carried these Bibles that are the eternal, inspired, inerrant Word of God. And you said in John chapter 14, Jesus, that you left your Holy Spirit, and one of the roles he would play would be to be our teacher. And so may we have an open heart and an open ear as individuals, marriages, family, and as this church family to hear what you have to say to us, Holy Spirit. Even for those that would be here gathering and those listening on the internet that have yet to surrender to you, yet to give their life to you. Would you speak to them? And would you help remove all of the excuses that have held them back from giving their life to you? And we just pray that this would be such a sweet time. We would sense your presence, that the joy of the Lord would be in this place as we talk about eternal matters this morning in 1 Peter chapter 1. So bless this time, anoint this time. We pray, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, why don't you take like a minute and turn around and find some people, say hello to them, make them feel welcome.
Steak and Study Time again, August 21st, 6:30, and the cost is $15 before that last Sunday and $20 after that. Menu is going to be Hawaiian. We're going to get a big pig. We're going to have macaroni salad. We're going to have white rice. We're going to have Hawaiian rolls. We're going to have watermelon. It's going to be a blast. Poncho Wars is coming out. It brings a strong message to us as men. Great opportunity to exercise personal outreach. So sign up online and bring them out.
We just enjoyed life so much. And it was kind of the dream family. We had four kids. They were all doing great. Our two older daughters had graduated from college. And actually, a week before, we were at my daughter's college where she was graduating from Cedarville University.
I just looked down the row and I just felt so blessed. I felt so proud. Everything just seemed so perfect.
She just was in awe of this family that God had given us.
And then suddenly I just started feeling like a panic feeling.
And she even said, "Please, Lord, don't let anything happen.
Don't let anything happen to any of my children."
And it was just 5 days later that Melissa was killed.
Our daughter Julie moved to an area to teach at a Christian school 2 months after Melissa died. Julie shared with her students about Melissa dying and about her life, and one little girl raised her hand and said, "I want to trust Jesus just like Melissa did, because I want to go to heaven like she did." We were so thrilled to know that someone had accepted Jesus. But I also felt like, why did my daughter have to die so that someone else would accept Jesus? I thought there's so many other ways that she could accept Jesus.
Melissa could have lived to a ripe old age, and she could have glorified God through her life with having children and many, many things that she could have done, and she would have done, I think. But I'm not God. I'm not omniscient. I'm not all-knowing. He is.
Trust is probably the hardest thing that I have trouble with.
How do you trust Him and not feel like God's going to take another child, and now we've got grandchildren in the picture? Is something going to happen to somebody? Trusting God is more real now than before. Before, it was more of an automatic thing. We're believers. We, you know, we put our faith in Christ. And sure, we trust God. That's what we do as Christians. Now it's more of an active thing. We're not waiting for the shoe to drop or anything like that, or waiting for something tragic to happen. We feel our job now is to do the next step in the whole process, and that is cling to God, trust Him, understand that He is sovereign and in control, and our lives are just going to have to be lived that way, with a tragedy in our background, but confidence that God knows what He's doing. You know, one could look at God's sovereignty and say, "You're pretty cold and indifferent about your daughter. It's okay, God." It's not okay. Let me tell you, it's not okay. I hurt every day for Melissa being gone, but I can't bring her back. I'm never going to see her again. That hurts. I'm never going to throw a softball with her again, or hug her, or hear her come home and say, "It's all good," which is one of her favorite sayings. So it hurts like everything to have her gone. But then on the other side, I have to think through the theology of it. He knew what He was doing, and we still love Him. And if we can have that be the message and God be glorified through this tragedy, then as much as it hurts, we're gonna be good with it.
GriefShare is a support group open to men and women dealing with the death of a loved one. To learn more about GriefShare, speak to the GriefShare leader at your church.
Hi everyone, Pastor Greg Laurie saying hello to all of you guys there at Calvary Chapel La Habra and my friend Lance Cook. Thank you for standing with us over the years at the SoCal Harvest. And guess what? We're doing it again in just days.
So there's three things you need to do. Number one, pray. Number two, invite. Number three, bring. Let's talk about the first one. We need to pray. When I say pray, I don't mean a generic Lord save the world prayer. I mean a specific prayer for a specific person that you know is not a Christian yet. Start praying for them by name. Secondly, invite them. Just call up that person you've been praying for and say, hey, you know what? I want to invite you to come with me to the SoCal Harvest. And thirdly, bring someone. Maybe that someone you invited will initially say no, but maybe then they'll change their mind and say yes. So here is your mission, should you decide to accept it. Pray, invite, and bring a non-believer with you to the SoCal Harvest. And I hope to see you there. God bless you.
I am a breast cancer survivor. I was diagnosed at the age of 29, had a mastectomy and chemotherapy, and was just so overwhelmed and scared and did not know where to turn for answers.
I remember going for my yearly mammogram, and I've never had any problems before. I knew in my heart of hearts something was up. And the doctor came in and told me that you have breast cancer in both breasts.
In that search for answers and the meaning of life, if I were to die, is when I found Christ.
When I heard that news, my heart jumped a couple times, but immediately my mind went to God's word, that He would never leave me or forsake me, and that nothing could touch me without it going through God's mighty righteous right hand. And that's exactly what happened.
I had so much hope that no matter what happened to me, whether I lived or died, there was a future for me and I would go to heaven.
I picked up the phone, I walked out of there. I called church, I called Lori Cook. Lori said to me, Kathy, have you talked to anybody here at church? I said, no. She goes, have you talked to Charity?
I know what it's like to be scared, to face those fears and really have to search deep for answers. I can understand and relate to the unique things that we face as cancer survivors and those fears that might want to creep in.
And I was just so blessed to know that I could pick up the phone and call her. And I did. And I was amazed that she was there to help me right then and there, say the right things, to encourage me. And that's what this ministry, this precious ministry, is all about, is to help one another and encourage one another.
I remember how helpful it was for me to have other women who had been through cancer pray with me, support me, go to doctor's appointments with me, and just be there for me in those deep, dark times.
We prayed it through, and the fear left, because fear is not of God. And God's word took charge of every bit of everything that I went through, and it was wonderful. And it's only because I had others here helping me. It's a marvelous thing to have support when you're going through something that can be so devastating. We're here to say that we've both been through the cancer. Mm-hmm. We've both been through it, and we have survived. And we survive because of Christ and prayer and coming together, mm-hmm. one another, helping each other. So we're here to say, come on, let us help you hold your arms up and encourage you in God's word, because God Almighty is going to win this battle.
That's wonderful. How's everyone doing this morning? Good. My name is Brian. I'm with Harvest Crusades with Pastor Greg Laurie. And I'm here to do a little, just two things. First, to let you know that the Harvest Crusade is next weekend. So how many of you guys have gone to a Harvest Crusade? Wow, wonderful. So next weekend, we have our 29th annual Harvest Crusade. And so we need some helpers at this event. We are a little short on follow-up workers, which are counselors on the field. And so I just really want to encourage you guys, if you have any time or if you're going to be there, please, we need your help. You can go to the back table and register to help us with the follow-up counseling part. And even if you don't know what day you can serve, just come over, sign up, and if you do end up showing up on one of those days, You're registered and you're ready to go. And if you're not able to show up, it's okay. We're going to depend on the Lord, and he's going to follow through as always. And so, please, we need your help. And secondly, we need you to pray, invite, and bring, as Pastor Greg said it. Pray for a non-believer, a family member that does not know Jesus. Invite them to the crusade, meaning you need to go and, hey, invite them, say, hey, I'll bring you with me. Just ride with me in my car. You know, I will buy you an In-N-Out burger, $5, okay? And bring them to the crusade and watch the Holy Spirit move and the power of the gospel change their life. And so, man, we're in this endeavor together. We love Pastor Lance and Calvary Chapel La Habra here. And we just want to see this community be changed by the gospel. And so we all have an opportunity. Not only I, but you as well, have an opportunity to leverage this event, to reach out to our community of those that don't know Jesus, and to bring them to a neutral venue where they're going to hear the gospel message. And so if you guys can pray and consider that, that'd be wonderful. But again, if you can also help with the crusade and being a five-minute friend to those people that are making professions of faith on the field, we can really use your help in that area. So please consider, pray for that, and we hope that God just brings in the harvest and that many people would just be saved and fall in love with Jesus as their Savior. So again, thank you for your time, and we'll see you next weekend. God bless.
Good morning. By a show of hands, how many of you have ever shared your faith with another human being? Raise your hands up. Look around. Put them down. I'm setting you up. By a show of hands, how many of you would share your faith again with another human being? Keep them up. Keep them up. Let's pray. Father, you see our hands, my hand, our hands. There are many that over this next weekend will find their way to that field because they are ready to give their life to you. And how important that is, that when they're done praying that prayer, there's just a convinced Christian, someone that's walked in the kingdom under the King, to talk to them about that journey. And Lord, stir our hearts. There's a reason you bring this crusade into our backyard. Stir our hearts to just set aside the time to make ourselves available and to love people once they give their life to you. Bless Greg, all of these that will share over the weekend, and may many, many come to know you as their Savior. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. 1 Peter chapter 1. We are still in the intro, really. We have learned a bit about the man Peter, have we not? He was, of course, one of the 12 apostles, and he introduces himself as not his given name. His given name was Simon, but his identity that Jesus had given him, that he would be a little stone, a rock, and that's the Greek word Petra. It's Peter, and so he, years later, after following Jesus and becoming a leader in the church, Peter would be writing this letter now, and he would identify himself as just such, the new identity that Christ has given me. I'm Peter. And he would also talk about, in that introduction, the mission that Jesus had given him. I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ. And we know that when Jesus first met Peter, changed his identity. The second time he would see him, he would be out fishing. And through that conversation, he would give him his commission. He'd say, no longer are you going to be just fishing for fish, but you will from now on be a fisher of men. And so here's Peter. Here's the transformed Peter, the same one who denied Jesus and deserted Jesus, is the same one that has had his life radically altered by Jesus, and now a shepherd himself. We talked in that first study in that introduction, the shaping of a shepherd. We went through his life, and now we have a letter penned down, of course, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, as all the Scripture is, but again, I think it's important, as we've talked about, to understand the character of the man in order to understand a bit better the character of this letter. And that's what it is. It's a letter. And he's writing, as it says here, to those that are dispersed. That would be Romans. There would be Greeks, there would be Jews, there would be Gentiles that are now saved, and they're scattered around the Roman Empire, but he's honing in on Asia Minor, what would be known today as those encamped in Turkey. During this time, around 64 AD, the church was going through some radical persecution. And so the letter, the thrust of the letter, if you're a note taker, and I always encourage everybody, if you're going to come here, just write three things down. Three nuggets. And the one would be, as we saw in the theme here, the theme would be Christ gives hope in hurtful times. And we're going to keep coming back to that. As we looked at the recipients of this letter, in order to really talk about the hope that will sustain them in hurtful times, he first begins to talk about the one who gives them hope, where they find hope in hurtful times. How does he do that? He reminds them of their position in God, before God. They are his elect. And we talked about that word elect. It's a deep doctrine, but the Greek word of that title, as he would say, you are God's elect, would be a choosing, that God chose us out of the world and for himself. He chose us out of the world and for himself. And we said the purpose, he mentions a couple of things, that one would be for sanctification. And that supports the idea. It speaks of being set apart. And the idea of that word hagiosmos in the Greek, sanctification, that we are set apart from the world, from one kingdom, the kingdom of darkness, and we're born again, and into the kingdom of light, God's kingdom. But sanctification also has a more practical daily-day application, that he chose us not only to be his, to be part of his kingdom, but he also chose us to be holy, and that would be set apart daily as we turn to him, as sinners that will sin from time to time, and he is appropriating or applying the shed blood of his son to forgive us of our sins. So once he does that, he gives them the basic greetings of their day. He would say, you know, grace and peace to you guys. Grace, of course, charis, the Greek greeting. Hey, unmerited favor to you guys. And then he would say peace. That's the Hebrew greeting, or shalom. And we talked about when it comes to both grace and peace, these are important words to understand, to really understand as they are used in Scripture, connected in association with God saving us. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, for by grace we are saved. It's important to understand how that works. God saves us. We receive salvation as a free gift. We look at peace as well. Peace, as it's used in Scripture, associated to God saving us, is the result of his saving us. We are born sinners with sinful natures. We are estranged from God. We are alienated from God. We actually are at enmity with God. We need peace with God. And when we are born again, when we give our life to God, come to him on his terms and allow him to save us, we now begin to have peace with God. And once we experience peace with God, we can then begin to experience the peace of God. And so he's going to move into this specific topic of hope. Again, writing to people that need grace, that need peace. That's why he's like, may it be multiplied to you. You're not thinking in those terms unless you have a heart for hurting people and know that people are hurting. And that's Peter. Now he begins to describe some incredible things that we as believers possess. And these are things that he's focusing on relating to believers that are hurting. What is it that God wants us to know when we hurt, when we're facing quite possibly extreme opposition or persecution? Well, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again, and here's what he's going to talk about, to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Whenever anything is living, it has life in it. The world knows about hope, but there's only one source of hope that actually has life in it, and it's the living hope that we read about here. Living hope that is based on and rooted in the living Word of God and the living Son of God. For Peter and the rest of the disciples, when they first met Jesus, that's when their hope first became a reality. Why? Because they were good Hebrew boys, for the most part. And they were waiting for their Messiah. When Jesus was introduced to Peter, as his brother would say, "I found the Messiah," he would bring Peter to Jesus. Peter met the Messiah, someone he had hoped for as a Jewish boy. Looking at the scriptures, he hoped for the Messiah. The second that he saw Jesus and began to believe that he was the Messiah, that hope in finding the Messiah now began to take hold of his heart. There was life. And that hope that Peter and the disciples had was challenged from time to time. It was challenged when Jesus would talk about his death. Seven times the Gospels talk about how Jesus himself talks about how he would die by way of crucifixion, that he would be buried. And he would always, I think four of the seven times he would talk about, on the third days he would be raised from the dead. The disciples seemed to not connect with that portion, the resurrection, until after they actually saw him raised from the dead. So to them, these Hebrew guys, hoping for a Messiah, they really were hoping for a political leader. They too, when Jesus came on the scene, as they walked with him, they were living under the tyranny of Rome. They hated the Roman pressure. They hated how Rome ruled over the land. They hated it. And they were like, "This guy's going to liberate us politically, and he's going to set up his kingdom." They knew enough about the Old Testament as to the Messiah setting up a kingdom, and they thought, for sure he's going to do that, and here and now. And of course, they always argued as to who would sit on his right and who would sit on his left. But that hope would be challenged, because each time Jesus talked about his death, that didn't fit into their idea of a Messiah. And so hope would be challenged. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus would talk in detail that the chief priests would turn him over and the rulers and how he would be crucified and whatnot. And remember, Peter took him off to the side and rebuked him? What kind of hope is that? That's not a living hope, not a growing hope. No, hope stopped in its tracks in Peter's mind when he thought that Jesus would die and stay dead. You remember in Luke chapter 24, there were, after the resurrection, on the first day of the week, when the day Jesus was raised from the dead, there's an account in Luke 24 of two disciples, not the original 12, but two other followers of Christ, and they were going home to Emmaus. And Jesus appeared to them, but he kind of held back their ability to recognize him at first. And he's like, "Hey, what are you guys talking about?" And they just kind of, "What do you mean? You a stranger or something? Everybody knows what just happened in Jerusalem." And they went on to say that they were basically, you know, they were following this one man, this Jesus of Nazareth, this one who was a prophet. He was mighty in word and he was mighty in deed before all of the people. But the chief priests and our rulers, man, they had him crucified. They condemned him to death. And then it says, "But we were hoping that he was the one that would redeem Israel." And Jesus looked at them and he's like, "Oh, foolish ones and slow of heart, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and entered into glory? Don't you know what the prophets and the scriptures had to say? How could you have not connected the dots?" And beginning at Moses, all the way through the prophets, he gives them this Bible study, expounding to them all of those things concerning himself. And it was at that point that he would, towards the end of his journey with him, he would have communion with them. And it's believed that it was looking at the scars that these guys who were leaving Jerusalem with no hope, would turn around and run back to Jerusalem filled with hope and find the disciples and tell them who they had seen. What was the difference? What brought their hope to a point of being living hope? What made it alive? The resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hope was renewed. Hope was alive. And because our hope is alive, it grows and it becomes more beautiful with time. Time destroys most hopes. They fade away. If you're hoping for something and it doesn't happen, and you keep hoping and it doesn't happen, and you keep hoping and it doesn't happen, hope begins to fade. But as we walk with the Lord, as we begin to understand more about Him and His Word, this living hope continues to grow. And it grows because, man, living hope has an answer for death. Living hope has the answer because the one that we put our hope in has conquered death. Jesus' resurrection was an open demonstration of His victory over death. His resurrection validates His ability and validates His authority to provide life after death. That's why He said to Martha, right before He'd raise Lazarus from the dead, showing He has power over death, He would say, "You need to understand, Martha," His sister who was weeping over His being dead for 4 days, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in Me, even though he dies, he will live. And whoever lives and believes in Me will never die." And He's like, "Do you believe this?" And I love her answer because, "Yes, Lord, I do believe that You are the Christ, the Son of God that has come into the world." In Revelation chapter 1, John has a vision of the future. It starts off with looking up into heaven. He sees the throne. God allows him to see the throne itself. And basically he sees, you know, Jesus in heaven, clothed with a garment down to His feet, and His eyes are like a flaming fire, and the radiance that's beaming from His clothes and His body is like bright as snow, white as wool. And then John says, "I just saw Him and I fell at My feet." In verse 17, it says, "But He laid His right hand on Me and He says, 'Listen, this is important. Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am He who lives and was dead. And behold, I'm alive forevermore.'" He goes, "Amen." But then he says this, "And I have the keys to Hades and death." What does that mean? In the ancient world, keys represent authority. Jesus, in that glorified state, in that resurrected state, said that by virtue of My resurrection, I have absolute authority over death. And thus, we look at life and we see, well, what's the most difficult part of life? It might be a very serious illness. It might be a very serious tragedy, a crisis. But ultimately, one of the most gripping, most powerful forces we'll ever face is death itself. But Jesus wants us to know, and here in this scripture, to those that are hurting, He wants those people to know that He is living hope. For you that were, before you were saved, I know you don't like to look back too far into those days, but do you remember what it was like when you had no hope in Jesus Christ? You just had no hope. Do you remember what it was like fearing death because you had no hope? Do you remember that gripping fear? Believers, of course, we don't have that gripping fear. We have a conviction that we will live beyond the grave because the one that has saved us has conquered the grave. In Hebrews chapter, I think it's around chapter 2, verses 14 and 15, it says, "Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood," speaking of Jesus, he's like, you know, He took on flesh and blood as well, "that through death He might destroy him who had power over death," that is the devil, talking about what Jesus would do on the cross, "and," I like this, "release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to that bondage. There are so many people living in this world that are shackled by the fear of death. In the early church, writing to these Christian Jews that were trying to run away from Christianity because of persecution, they were fearing death. And he's like, hold on. We have fallen in love with, we've given our life to one that has taken on flesh so that he might find victory over death, conquer death. Thus, when you know that and it's a reality in your heart, you're no longer shackled. You're no longer subject to that fear. 1 Corinthians 15, 53 through 58. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying which is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? Well, the sting of death is sin, and the sting of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And I love this. Because of that, therefore, he says, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Living hope is what allowed a father to stand up here on this stage on Friday night and eloquently, lovingly, passionately, tearfully describe the life of his daughter, who was taken home to be with the Lord at the age of 20. Living hope is what brought him to the reality of talking about the strong points in her life, the weak points in her life, but to talk about her faith, Desiree's faith, and the reality of that faith, and how he now knows, because she believed in Jesus and her faith was in Jesus Christ, she is with him now. That's what living hope does for a believer. It's living hope that allows the husband, Chris, to stand up here and honor his wife, Joan, on Saturday morning and talk about his love for her and her faith as she struggled 4 years with cancer. It was living hope that gives Chris and his family and us here that love and miss Joan and love and miss Desiree. It's the living hope of Jesus Christ, the one that conquered death and offers us victory over death, life after death, that allows us to put a smile on our face and go, we'll see him again. When Paul described death, I always share this scripture in my funerals, and we've had our fair share of them around here this year, so I get to see people on a regular basis in settings where there's either an urn or a coffin or a casket or a gravesite or whatnot, and I'm quite taken back by how many people these days in California, in America, when I begin to talk about what the Bible says about life and death being part of life and eternity, how bewildered many people look. It's like the first time they've ever heard it. Our world is filled with opinions as to what eternity is about and what death is about, but our Creator, the one that made us, he's got something to say as well. And he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that when our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, eternal in the heavens. And he's like, we groan as believers. And this we groan. We like, I'd like to be there. Not to be unclothed, but further clothed. That this right now, this mortality, might be swallowed up by life. What kind of life? Eternal life. And he goes on to say, now he who has prepared us for this very thing is God. He's given us his spirit as a guarantee. Thus, we as believers, we walk in this confidence knowing that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And I break it down as simple as this. Like a guy came up to me, I think Saturday morning, he goes, you know, I really appreciate the fact that like as you explain this, you like made us thirsty. But then you finished and you gave us a drink. You and I, we look at this room, we don't see the real you and I. We see temporary dwelling places called tents. God, he reached down into the ground and he took from dust and he formed Adam. 17 elements, and he formed Adam. And he put his hands over his nose, and he breathed life into Adam. And our Creator now saw a living being. That same God. Look around. Look at how cool God creates. Look at how cool he does life. He takes this planet that he created, and he put it in this particular galaxy, in this solar system, exactly where it would be, in the exact proximity where life, human life, animal life, fish life, fowl life, that's birds, would fowl too, fowl in other ways too, but where, like, this is where life is going to live. They're trying to find life everywhere else. Okay, great. But this is where God made life. Read your Bibles. God created Earth, and that's where life as we know it would live. Because of sin, because of the fall, death entered into life. Every single one of us are born into this world as created beings of God, and every single one of us have life, life that will end. Not permanently. If you look up the Webster Dictionary, the Webster's Dictionary definition of death, say that three times fast, it basically talks about ceasing to exist. But none of us here are going to cease to exist. The real you and I, we're souls. That's what we are. The real you and I are souls. And this body, your body, every one of our bodies is subject to the second law of thermodynamics. The only thing that is not in this world is that which is eternal, the Word of God and the work of God. Everything else is dying. Even the chairs that you sit on are decaying. Our air conditioning units, decaying. Especially this week. I look in the mirror, you look in the mirror. If you're honest, I don't care how you fix it up, dress it up, paint it up. It'd be dying. And here's the scary thing. Many of us as Christians, we live our life that involves death, as if it's never going to come our way. And many are afraid of dying. I want you to think about what we've been reading and what we're going to continue to read. And I want you to really think through, if we really believe this, should we have that gripping fear of death? No, we shouldn't. But the real you and I, one day, the real you and I, the soul, will put off this mortality, because none of this is designed for eternity. It's not eternal. Your soul will go on, and it will either spend eternity in heaven with God, because you made your reservation down here in your tent. Or your soul will live on in a place of torment called hell because you chose to reject God and his salvation. It's not going to force anybody to have a relationship with him down here, especially throughout eternity. So the second we put off this tent as believers, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Now, as we look at this, we've got to ask ourselves, okay, when does this living hope become ours? Notice, you know, here he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy, so really, Peter's thanking God for this. He's like, he's begotten us again to this living hope. What does that word begotten mean? Born. We've been born into the kingdom, born into the family of God. And when we're born again into the kingdom, into the family of God, we now have this living hope. Before we're born again, no living hope. Once we're born again, the moment we're born again, living hope. And the living hope is eternal life. And understand that everlasting life is not something that I will have one day when I die. We as Christians have everlasting life right now. Right now. If I die today, that's what I experience. I have it right now. I'm not experiencing it right now, but it's part of my future right now. When it comes to death and eternity, people without Christ, they have something as well. When it comes to death and eternity, people with Christ have living hope. When it comes to people without Christ, they have a living fear. It's a living fear and a living disparity. And it's fascinating from my vantage point, I'm around funerals a lot, like I said, to see the people who are secure in their relationship with God and that living hope, the closer they get to death, that living hope intensifies. When they get around death, the living hope intensifies. But people without Christ, that living fear, that gripping fear we talked about, and that living disparity, when they get around death or they become close to death themselves, that also intensifies. It's glaring. Peter is absolutely grounded in this living hope that is rooted in a living Savior. Remember, he's writing from firsthand experience. In his second letter, in chapter 1, verse 16, he would say, you know, listen, we didn't just follow cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses. Remember Resurrection Sunday in John chapter 20? Mary comes to the tomb first, and the angel's like, he ain't here, he's risen. Go and tell, you know, the disciples. And she runs to Peter and John's house, and John, of course, is writing, and he's like, yeah, me and Peter, God, we just bolted to the tomb. I beat him there. You know, he looked in first. He saw and believed, that word Ido, that he looked intently, and he saw and believed. And then it says that Peter looked in, and he went in, and he saw the grave clothes lying off to the side and the headpiece lying off to the side, everything all neatly folded. In other words, Peter was face-to-face with a bodily resurrection. You know, later on that same day, the first disciple to see Jesus would be the one that denied him three times. There's a private meeting between Jesus and Peter there in Luke chapter 24. Later on in John 20, he would appear to all of the disciples except for Thomas. Thomas is like, I'm not going to believe unless I see, you know, the nail prints and all that. You know, a week later, he'd appear to all the disciples. Of course, Judas is off the scene by then, but Thomas would be there. The next chapter in John 21, he would meet 17 of the disciples on the Sea of Galilee. There, Peter would swim in. They would have breakfast with Jesus. Jesus would pull Peter off to the side, and he'd talk to them, hey, you love me? And twice he would talk to him about tending his sheep. Once he would focus on teaching his sheep. There's a lesson there for all of us. In Matthew 28, he would appear to 11 of the disciples on a mountain in Galilee. We know that at the Ascension, 11 of the disciples, minus Judas, they were all there and saw Jesus in his glorified body go up. And that's why Luke would write in the first part of Acts. Luke was the author of Acts as well. And he would say, you know, the former account I gave, O Theophilus, of what Jesus began to do and to teach until the day in which he was taken up, and how he presented himself alive after his suffering, how he showed himself alive after his death with many infallible proofs. Being seen by them, being seen by the disciples over a 40-day period of time, and focusing in and speaking on things pertaining to the kingdom of God. You guys need to know about this. You need to get people into my kingdom. And here we are now in this letter, almost 30 years later, writing to displaced believers, scarred by the flames of persecution, hurting in an just an unthinkable, unimaginable hurt, with every earthly reason to give up hope. God, through Peter, pens down these words. Oh, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Just according to his mercy. He's just going to give you what you don't even deserve. That's mercy. He's caused us to be born again to a living hope. So number one, we can rejoice in suffering because we have a living hope. Number two, we can rejoice in suffering because we have a permanent inheritance. Look at verse 4. To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. What's Peter talking about? He's talking about all of the blessings that await us in heaven. Yeah, we have everlasting living hope. And we have everlasting life because of where we've placed our faith. When we get to heaven, we will be in eternity, and we will see an eternal inheritance awaiting us. An inheritance that Jesus himself said he would be going and working on. Remember John 14? He just says, I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, I'm going, Lance, to prepare a place for you, that where I am in eternity, you may be also. We look at what Jesus as creator did in 6 days. Look at the universe. Look at all of creation. We're like, wow. Think of what he's been doing since his ascension. And he's going to personally. Oftentimes, inheritance is left by someone that's no longer part of your life. But Jesus says, I'm going to go prepare the inheritance. And when you get there, I'm your inheritance as well. I'm going to receive you into myself. Heaven will be greatly heaven because of Jesus being in heaven. I at least got 4 amens in the first service when I said that. This far outweighs any earthly inheritance. This far outweighs every earthly inheritance that has ever been, combined with every earthly inheritance that will ever be. And that's because we are children of a king, the King of Kings. We share his inheritance. We are included in Jesus' last will and testament. Romans 8, 15, for you did not receive, speaking to believers, the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. And it's like, look, I consider the present sufferings of this present time. They're not even worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. And so our inheritance is incorruptible. Nothing can run it. It can never pass away. I was reading something the other day. It was an article. It's like, son of some wealthy guy receives inheritance and squanders it the evening he receives it. And I'm like, what was that about? And a father gave his son a $600,000 car. And the picture was the car wrapped around a tree. And it's like, hope he had insurance, question mark. The inheritance that's reserved for us, nothing can run it. It's incorruptible. It's undefiled. It can't be blemished. It can't be cheapened or lessened in any way. And it does not fade away. It will never wear. It will never grow stale. It will never grow old. It will, because it's eternal. Listen, part of our inheritance will be something tangible. You're going to get there and you're going to see. You're going to see heaven. All of the manifestation that the Bible talks about as far as the throne of God. When John, in chapter 21 of the book of Revelation, begins to describe the new earth and new heaven, he sees the new Jerusalem, like the capital of heaven, where we're going to be, descending from heaven, adorned like a bride. And this is how he described it. God let him see it. So you're like, what's heaven like? Read Revelation 21. It's like, well, the city itself, it comes down, and it says that it's so bright and so brilliant that it looks like a diamond. He uses the word jasper. And he's like, and the foundations are just filled with these gorgeous, just priceless jewels, just this thing, this floating in the air. There's 12 gates. The gates are pearls, giant pearls. They're massive. He measures it. It's 1,500 by 1,500 by 1,500, this massive cube. If God were to give us each just, you know, a section of the city itself, we would have like this massive area. But then we have the new created earth and all that's outside the city of heaven. On each of the gates, there's these individuals that are going to be standing like a heavenly usher's ministry. The names of the apostles are on the doors. On the foundation are the, excuse me, on the foundation is the names of the apostles. On the doors of the gates are the names of the tribes. It's a picture of saying all of my people down through the ages, the gates are open, are welcome. Come on in. You that have come to right standing with me. And it says that in heaven, there'll be no sun, no need for it, because the glory of God will be radiating through all of these spectacular visual things. And then you're going to have the 24 elders. You're going to have the throne of God. You're going to have the redeemed around the throne. Now check this out. I know sometimes here, worship for some of us, there was a day when you never yawned during worship. You were so engaged with the Lamb that your spirit was alive. You didn't care who was around you. You just worshiped Him. But you know as well as I do, don't read His love letter. Don't talk to Him. Don't worship Him. Give your time, talent, and treasure to this world. Start focusing, and that's that worship stuff starts to fade. And all of a sudden, there's no rush to get in here and worship. It's like, that's just, and it fades. You know what I'm talking about. But that will never happen in heaven. Jesus is your inheritance, and it won't fade. Worship will always be insane. For you that have never raised your hands, you'll never put them down. For you that have never fallen on your face before the Lord, you won't get up. I'll be coming and going, I told you so, and y'all, leave me alone. I got another 200 years on my face. Leave me alone. It's reserved in heaven for us. You ever went somewhere, you had a reservation, and they're like, nah. I remember one time I traveled to Japan. Man, it was the longest trip. It was supposed to be a 13-hour flight. It took 15. Jetstream was working the wrong direction. We got into Tokyo late. Traffic was backed up. It took us 3 hours to take this bus into Tokyo. I was like, give me a bed. I go to this hotel. There it is. Had a few other pastors with me. I'll go in, man. Our office made the reservations. I got the this, that. I'm on. I go walking in. How you doing? And Japanese are so polite, so nice. Shimasen. Oh, seem to say. Here's my reservation. Look in the computer. Oh, no see a Rance Cook anywhere in our computer. It's Lance. Oh, no Lance either. Oh, check again. They get a manager. In Japan, when they're like done with you, they do this. When they do this, yeah, they're done. So this guy walks out, so polite. Senor Lanson, yeah. I'm no room for you. Your name, no. You. Next. I'm still upset over that. You're not going to get to heaven, and there's some, like, you know, celestial host. Let's see here. And it's not going to be Peter. Peter at the pearly gates. No. Read through Revelation 20. There's no Peter anywhere around. You're going to get to heaven, and your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's in. This is real. It's not going to be spoiled. Someone's not going to, like, you know, as we see inheritances here, getting squabbled for and fighting for, and then, you know, relatives come and, like, rip it off from here. It's there. You're going to go, and they're going to be like, Lance, we've been waiting. Finally. And hopefully we'll hear those words. Well done, good and faithful servant. Be faithful in the little things. Enter into what? The joy of the Lord. And we all trip out about streets of gold. I don't think we're going to be like, whoa, trip out. Dude, you see the streets of gold? Come here. Yo, I'm going to scratch some of this and make a ring. No. That's asphalt up there. We're going to trip out on a lot of stuff. We're going to trip out on each other. In a new glorified state, you that are short, probably tall. Bald dudes, big ol' afros, I don't know. Whatever that glorified body is, it's designed for heaven. And then we're going to get the dwelling place thing, the city thing. And let me tell you what I can't wait for. And I mean this. I don't know how many people I've stood in front of their caskets as believers. And I told their loved ones, we're hugging them again. And I can't wait to feel them. Heaven's going to be all about resurrection. I can't wait to just Desiree, Joan. The list goes on. I can't wait. My grandpa, he got saved at, I think, 81 and died at 82. Gramps. I love the second service because I can just keep going. It's great. I'll do verse 5 for you guys next week. I did get through this. But the last thing, and you can just contemplate this. We can rejoice in suffering because we have a living hope. We have a permanent inheritance. And we are protected by the power of God, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last day. Not only do we have this eternal, a living hope and an eternal inheritance awaiting us in heaven, not only is God keeping that for us, hear me, He's keeping us for that. All of what God has made us as His elect, sanctified, washed by the blood of Jesus Christ, all that God has made us and all of what God has for us is kept by His power, not us. The word kept there is a military term. He's guarding it. He's like, I know what you need, Lance, in assistance and help to get you right now from here to up there with me. And it'll be my power working in and through your life. Don't you dare take credit. Lean on me. Seek me. Trust me. Rely on me. For it's God who works in us to will and to do for His good pleasure. And the words that Jesus spoke in John 10 will be fulfilled. My sheep hear my voice. I know them. And they follow me. And I give them eternal life. And they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. Let's pray. Lord, amazing words. Amazing words you've given us here. Words of encouragement. Words of help, words of strength. I pray that we will continue to turn to you when we walk out of this place, turn to your word, trust you. You would continue this work you've begun in our heart throughout this day, throughout this week. Bless these people here in this service, Lord. Bless their marriages, families. Lord, bless their work. Their homes, keep them safe and healthy and keep them in love with you. Keep us all in love with you, Lord. You're a good God. Thank you for the work that you do in our life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's all stand. Last study, we did give an invitation for people. We ran out a little late, but I would just encourage you, Robbie and me are going to just play a last song, and if you would, just hang out and worship with us this last song, but we're going to have some people here from our prayer ministry that will be up front as well. And if you need prayer for anything, especially if you're one of those people that would be here or even on the internet where you're like, if my life were to end today, I just don't know. I don't know that I would go to heaven. And you'd want someone to pray with you and make sure that that's right between you and God, coming to Him on His terms. Or you're a prodigal. You've walked away from the Lord. and he's got your attention. Just come up here and just there'll be some people to pray with you. We love you guys. God bless you. Pray for our fishing trip. We will have insane fish tacos if we do good. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Bless you guys. Have a great week.